2002 was a watershed year for the agency cleaners working on the London Underground. Previously refused access to any union, the newly elected General Secretary of the Rail and Maritime Transport Union, Bob Crowe, allowed the cleaners to join his union. Work immediately began on organising the cleaners, with Nigerian-born Clara Osagiade at the forefront of an incredible drive for better pay and conditions.
Yeah, I started as a cleaner on London Underground in 1990, and it was very tough. I was more or less like treated like a slave. You know, we were not unionized, and we were not allowed to be in any union, and we were highly exploited. So I mean, I could remember we would work for certain hours, and you'll be short paid. And when you ask for your rightful payment, you just be sacked. And how they sack you, they just tell you, don't come back. It's so easy, because there was no binding contract. We had to go from station to station, speaking to individuals. I remember one particular night when I went to Modern Depot, because what the employers did is to instill fear in them. And so to kind of remove that fear, you need to do a lot of talking and convincing. And so you doing the talking, you must be very equipped. And of course, I have to tell them that I'm a migrant as well. So, but I'm standing up. In that depot, we had just 4 members, and they were about 30-something workers. And we knew that we cannot call a strike in such a condition. I mean, if 4 workers don't turn up, it doesn't mean anything. It won't have any effect. So we were faced with the task of convincing others to join the union. So I spoke for almost 35 minutes. At a point, I noticed there was a complete silence. And after that speech, they all came up, they all accepted. And we recruited 21 members that night. And that's how we went, to other depots and stations. But we had reps too who would go on days to talk to the day shift, and then the morning shift, the afternoon, the evening, and then the night. And some of us, we were even doing all 3 shifts, Each time we went to a work location, we take note of their facilities. We discovered shocking discoveries that some of them didn't even have a mess room, which we came back, we reported to Unity House, that's the RMT. And of course, the RMT, being an all-grace union, that's the beauty about this union. The RMT was quick to respond. London Underground was made to fulfill their own obligation in giving mess rooms. And so that in itself showed that, the union can be helpful, and that's, help to convince them that, they should really join it. We had this idea. We knew we wanted the better terms and conditions. But we could not do it on our own. We needed to, carry everyone on board. And that in itself was the key. One of the challenges I had was that I had to lead a group of men who are predominantly Africans. And in fact, in Africa, there's this idea, cultural belief, that women, you should listen. The man is your head, the boss, the black. Of course, we had to study and find a way we could work around that. And of course, they feel, can a woman do this? I had to overcome that by working harder than my predecessor who is a man, trying to get to reach out this culture, this vast, because the task we had was we were dealing with people from a vast cultural background. So we needed to find how do we approach these people. Being the campaign started as a political campaign with True Bob Crow, the union True Bob Crow. And then it was when they failed to listen, we felt we needed to have an industrial action. For a successful strike to have an impact, for a strike to have an impact, you must have at least 80 to 90% of membership in that work location. Having that in mind, we set out to first campaign and recruit. So we were recruiting and then campaigning at the same time. And so when we felt we had a very strong membership at every workplace, we called for a strike action. When we balloted, we had a 99.2% yes vote. It was a very successful strike. And after the first 24 hours, we were called to a table talk because London Underground lost a lot of money. The trains were stopped. They couldn't go in service. We were given the London Living Wage and the holiday, which were 28 days, which we did not, we did not have. When we started this struggle, a lot of people told me a lot of things. "Yo, Clara, do you know what you're doing?" Because in the history of the London, even in England, cleaners were never organized, let alone to embark on a strike. So they were. I was always being forced to answer a question like, how on earth do you think you can achieve that? In fact, what I was told that I was embarking on Mission Impossible. But the mission became possible through perseverance, through long suffering, through, resilience, being resilient, pushing all the time, and it pays. And because we won the London Living Wage, we won the London Living Wage, the cleaners on the underground. And now the whole London is on London Living Wage. It gives me joy at times, our actions have sort of transformed London. And who knows, our continuous actions would transform Britain.